Hello, everyone. Hello, welcome. I'm going to allow more people to come in. I still see a few people in the waiting room. Just a few notes, though, before we begin. We are recording, so we ask that you continue to stay muted for this event, but there will be a Q&A portion where you can put your questions in the chat, and Brianna, our moderator, will read the questions to Briana Thomas, the author. Although we ask you to be muted, we encourage you to keep your cameras on to create a more community atmosphere. So please put your camera on so we can see your beautiful faces. Thank you so much for being here. Again, welcome. My name is Michaela. I'm the events coordinator here for Sankofa Bookstore, which is a Black-owned bookstore in Washington, D.C. And that is why we're so excited to have Black Broadway in Washington, D.C. Presented here tonight. We are a bookstore that dedicates itself on selling books that are by and about people of African descent. So again, as being a part of the legacy of Washington, D.C., we're so happy to have our guest here tonight. And don't forget, you can purchase Black Broadway in Washington, D.C. at sankofa.com or at our brick and mortar store at 2714 Georgia Avenue Northwest. So I'm not gonna keep rambling. Let me go ahead and introduce our guests tonight, who are Brianna Thomas and Brianna Rhodes. Brianna Thomas has been published in the Washingtonian magazine, the historic Afro-American newspaper, and the Washington Post throughout her journalism career. Brianna earned a Master of Journalism degree from the University of Maryland, College Park, and a Bachelor of Arts degree in English and communication from Greensboro College. Her fellow journalism colleague, Brianna Rhodes, is a DMV-based journalist and entrepreneur who has written for organizations such as Blavity Incorporated, the National Trust for Historic Preservation, The Griot, and the Afro-American newspaper. She is also the founder of a creative platform called Brianna Rhodes Writes. She earned a Master of Journalism degree from the University of Maryland, College Park, and Bachelor of Arts degree in English and Psychology from the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill. So if you're out there in the audience with your camera on, please give us a round of applause for our guest tonight. And I'm going to turn it over to Brianna Rhodes. Brianna, thank you so much for being here.
No problem. Thanks so much, Michaela. Hello, everyone, and thanks so much for joining. I'm so honored to be a part of this event today, and I'm so, so excited to talk to you, Brianna. How are you this evening?
I'm doing great. I'm so happy to be here. I'm so happy to see faces. Hi, everybody. Has your camera on. Thanks so much.
Wonderful. So let's jump right into the conversation. Can you talk about your book, Black Broadway in Washington, D.C., and give us a brief synopsis about the inspiration behind the book and what it's about?
Definitely. So my book, Black Broadway in Washington, D.C., it is a book that is based on the Black history of U Street. And it's so special to be here at Sankofa giving this talk because it's located on Georgia Avenue and has been for many years. And so this is also a part of U Street's Black history. But my book, the core of it is referring to the Black Broadway era. And the Black Broadway era is referring to the early 1900s, so about the mid-1900s, where the U Street corridor was the core place for commercial activity, for education, for innovation, for business, all for Black people. Everything was, for the most part, Black-owned, Black-funded, and Black-attended. And it was really a place of just liveliness and this sphere where you can go and have a good time and be your own person and just be free to be who you are.
Yes, wonderful. And I loved the way that you described Black Broadway. I want to reiterate this, right? It's described as having like a bustling nightlife, thriving Black-owned businesses, and being surrounded by some of the most brilliant minds we still look up to this day. It was like literally a Black Mecca. So can you provide more insight of how a typical day would be for a Black person living around or visiting U Street during that time?
Oh yeah, definitely. So U Street at that time is what you said is a Black Mecca, and specifically because of Howard University. If anybody's watching this and they are Howard alum, shout out to you. But Howard University really brought in a huge migration of African American people to DC. And what made Black Broadway so special at the time is because other areas, not just in Washington, but also throughout the nation, were plagued by Jim Crow laws, which was segregation. And so they literally could not go other places to eat, could not go other places to own their own homes, to open their own businesses, or even to have fun and go to jazz clubs and cabarets and dance halls. But you could do all those things on U Street. And so a typical day, I like to read this quote directly from my book, and it's from Richard Lee, who was actually one of the, he's not currently the operating as the CEO, but he is in the second generation of the founder of Lee's Flowers and Car Shop, which is one of the one out of three Black owned businesses remaining from the Black Broadway era. But he said this, and I just always like to read it. And he says this, he said, "Everybody knew everybody. We didn't miss going downtown. We didn't give a blank." I mean, excuse my language, but they wanted to have all that stuff to themselves. Fine. We had all this stuff to ourselves. And so that kind of tells you the spirit of Black Broadway. That is what it was like. It was a bustling nightlife, whether you were going to the caves to see Muhammad Ali down there. There's literally photographs of him visiting U Street, whether you're going to a concert at Howard Theater or Lincoln Theater, going to see Sarah Vaughan or Cab Calloway, all these great jazz names, or Duke Ellington, who grew up right within the U Street corridor on T Street, or going to go see the Homestead Grays play a baseball game at Griffith Stadium, which is now located where Howard University Hospital is. That was a typical day on U Street. Literally everybody knew everybody. You could go to the cafeteria at the YWCA and see Carter G. Woodson, the father of Black history, there having lunch. I mean, that was a typical day in Black Broadway.
It is so amazing. And I always think about, like, you know, just walking up and down the street and knowing that you could see someone famous, someone that is still like relevant to this day, like, wow, you will soon be a part of history. And I can't neglect the fact of the wonderful women that have graced the U Street corridor. And since this is Women's History Month, I want to highlight the ladies for a moment. Is that okay?
Yes.
Who are some prominent Black women we may know who are tied to U Street's unique history?
Yeah, so I think one that we may know is Mary McLeod Bethune, who she was a very vocal activist during that Black Broadway era during the 1900s. And she actually was a part of this movement, the Don't Buy Where You Can't Work. And we see things like that recently coming back alive with the Buy Black movement. But she teamed up with the New Negro Alliance. She would protest on U Street, and she actually founded the National Council of Negro Women. And another woman, Nannie Helen Burroughs, which is dear to DC. We even have a street named after her. But she wrote different works, and she was not just an educator, but she also spoke out specifically against colorism, because not only did Black people have to deal with prejudice and segregation when it came to other races, specifically white people, but also within our own race. And we see this unfortunately still today, but because she was a darker skin tone, she was not able to get the same jobs or the same school opportunities as maybe someone who was of a lighter skin tone were. And so she decided, well, if you don't want to hire me or you don't want to educate me, I'm just as educated as everybody else, I'm going to start my own school. And that's exactly what she did. And so she started the National Women's Training School for Women, and that was off of 50th Street. And then one more woman to highlight, which I actually, when you get the book Black Broadway, I have an entire subsection on Mary Church Terrell, which is probably a familiar name to those of you who know the history of U Street. But she actually was a teacher at M Street High School, which is now known today as Dunbar High School. And Dunbar High School was the first public school for Black students in the nation. That's how special U Street was. But Mary Church Terrell was a teacher there, and she also met her husband there, Robert Terrell. And back then on Black Broadway, they were somewhat of what they were, a power couple. I mean, like Obama and Michelle, they were who you wanted to see and be around at the time. And she was a very vocal activist as well. Her husband Robert Terrell went on to be the first Black federal judge. And Mary Church Terrell, she also was one of the founding members of the NAACP, and she also founded the National Association for Colored Women too. And so those are just some women that I would highlight. There are plenty more in the book, of course, but just some that you can take home with you and start the Google or something.
That's so amazing. When we talk about women in history, I always try to like reiterate to so many people that are close to me, like, we have history right at our fingertips, right? We could talk to our aunties, our grandmothers, our mothers, our uncles. so many people about the history that they've lived through and just being able to relate to that historic moments that we know from U Street, right? So you dedicated your book to your lovely grandmother, Miss Evelyn Thomas, and you mentioned how she shared some U Street memories with you and took you there to visit sometimes when you were younger. Also, viewers, if you live in the area or have ever visited U Street, please share your favorite memory in the Zoom chat. But Bri, can you tell us about the type of insight she provided for you while writing the book?
Yeah, so my grandmother, so I began my project of studying in the Black history of U Street specifically, because it started as a photo story essay in Washingtonian magazine. It started as an assignment, and actually with that assignment, I remembered the times that my grandmother had taken me to U Street as a child. And so that photo story essay, which published in 2017, then expanded into the book we now have. But I can remember then of me telling her like, hey, I have this project, tell me all about it. And she was ecstatic. I mean, she showed me pictures. She literally wrote down a list. I think at one of my other talks, I actually showed the list. I'm not doing that tonight, but she would tell me just growing up. I remember her taking me to Ben's Chili Bowl and the Howard Theater, and I remember her just telling me about her going to shows at the Howard Theater. She was seeing Red Fox and the comedian Moms Mabley, and there's this red carpet lounge hotel that she would tell me about. It's a dance hall, or what she would call hole in the wall spots. She went to the Caves, which for my millennials or the generation before us, you would know that as Bohemian Caverns, which is now closed, but in her day it was called the Caves, and then after that Crystal Caverns. But they had shake dancers in the basement, and it was just a great place to be. And I can remember not just her taking me to U Street, but all the time she told me about how she would go to this carry out and get chicken wings and fries, and how she would visit this place. And so when it came time for me to have the opportunity to actually present the history of U Street to the neighborhood or to this area, the first person I went back to was, of course, my grandmother. Because like you said, we have her stories literally right in our own backyard. And for me, my grandmother, Evelyn Thomas, she's that to me. She moved to D.C. from Suffolk, Virginia, when she was in her late teens, early 20s. And this was about maybe the 50s, early 50s and 60s. And this is not abnormal for Black women during that time. And I actually have a whole chapter in my book specifically talking about women migrating from the South to D.C. to get better opportunities, to have better jobs. And a lot of women during that day would work as live-in servants, or they would clean homes and things like that. And they would send money back to their families in the South. Well, my grandmother, she moved from Suffolk, Virginia to D.C., but she didn't end up being a live-in servant. She eventually worked for the federal government. But just really tying into that history of, a lot of times you hear about somebody famous like Duke Ellington, right? And you think that's so far from you, but your grandmother, your aunt, your uncle, you know, everybody is tied to this Black Broadway history, especially if you are a Washingtonian native, so.
Yeah. And one thing I love most about your book also is like the amazing photos that you have. And, you know, like sometimes you said, like whenever you interview Native Washingtonians and people that you used and mentioned in your book, how you would just provide a photo and it'll spark a memory. So how is that significant in making sure that, you know, these thoughts and these memories come alive and make sure that it was so vividly explained in your book?
Yeah, I think you hear the saying a lot of times, what is it called? A picture is worth a thousand words. Mm-hmm. I think that's so true. And for me, because my project literally began as a photo story essay, I had to take the time to pick out photos that would present the full history of U Street without words. And so I did have these community narratives that came from the Ali family at Ben's Chili Bowl, the Lee family at Lee's Flower and Card Shop, and also the Mitchell family at Industrial Savings Bank. And I'm shouting them out because out of the 300 Black-owned businesses that were a part of the Black Broadway era, which is what makes it so special, there are only three remaining Black-owned businesses on U Street today from that era. And so that's a drastic change in number. But that's why the pictures were so important, because when you go to U Street today, it doesn't look like how it looked during Black Broadway. But sparking those memories started a conversation and started to bring back this remembrance of a time where things were Black-owned, Black-funded, and also where it was a good time on U Street, where people were happy. Like I read the quote, they just wanted to do whatever they wanted to do without anybody telling them they couldn't. And that was very powerful for Black people to have that kind of spirit in a time of segregation, in a time where you literally have federal law saying you can't sit next to this person, you can't talk to this person, you can't go to school with somebody that doesn't look like you. And to have a place where U Street, where you could be an activist, where you could own your own home, where you could be a doctor or a lawyer, I mean, that's powerful. And we're still seeing the effects of that today.
Yeah. And speaking of, like, you know, places that are still alive, like you said, Ben's Chili Bowl. When I moved up here 6 years ago, I was so excited about visiting it. I need to get my chili cheese fries. I just need to experience this. This is like a historic landmark, right? But what are, I know you already mentioned a few, but what are some other remnants that people can see of Black Broadway today?
Yeah, so Ben's Chili Bowl, of course, you can go there and get a half smoke. If you go there on a Friday morning or Saturday morning, you may see Dr. Dumchuck, who wrote the epilogue to my book. He will teach you how to properly eat a half smoke. He's the historian of Ben's Chili Bowl. But some other remnants, I already mentioned Industrial Saving Bank, which was the first Black-owned bank.
Let me go then, because you got somewhere to be.
I also already mentioned Lee's Flower and Card Shop, but there are also during the Black Broadway era, what I didn't mention was outside of the 300 Black-owned businesses, there were about 100 Black-owned churches, and there are still churches there today. St. Luke's is there, House of Prayer is still there, 15th Street Presbyterian is still there, which actually 15th Street Presbyterian is who founded what we now know today as Dunbar High School. The school actually began in the basement of that church. The Anthony Bowen YMCA, which was the first YMCA for Black boys, that is still on U Street. Now the location has moved. It's no longer on 12th Street, but the building is still there. And the building is called the Thurgood Marshall Center. And you can go there, you can look inside. There's cool pictures. Some other remnants, True Reformers building. It's not open, but it's still right there on U Street. Bohemian Caverns, the building is there, can't get inside, but you can still look at it. And then the other thing that I will mention is Cultural Tourism does a actual walking tour. You can look it up and do it digitally, or you can go outside, stretch your legs a little bit, and literally walk from place to place to see all these amazing sites from the Black Broadway era.
Yes, amazing. And one thing I also love about, you know, your book and actually writing it, it's like it's bringing more attention for like millennials to learn about our history, right? I have been so invested in just Black history all over, you know, different neighborhoods all over the country I've been learning about. And I want to ask you, Bri, because we play a pivotal role as millennials to make sure that, you know, we're making sure that we honor our ancestors in any type of way possible. But what do you think Black millennials can do in reviving and preserving the legacy of our Black legends who paved the way and cultivated this culture for us that we still see through U Street today?
Yeah, so I would say the first thing is buy Black Broadway and read it. So you can get educated, because that's the first step, is to know your history, get educated, and also spend time with the historians that are in your household. There's no better narrative, right, than the history that comes from a grandparent or aunt or uncle. There's so many cool stories. That's actually why the back of my book is actually called The Voices of U Street, is because community narratives is so powerful to tell the story of U Street through the voices of people that actually lived on U Street, visited DC, spent time there, got educated there, any of the above. And I think as millennials, we have a job to get educated so we can pay homage to our past, but also inspire us to look towards our future. I think the other thing is to support Black businesses. I just named so many that you could go and visit that are still Black owned. There are some from Black Broadway era that aren't the same generation owners, like Florida Avenue Grill is still there. But yes, support the businesses that are on U Street and go and tell other people. You mentioned Black millennials, but I think a lot of times as well, what makes it so important with history is to make sure that not only us, that we aren't the only ones that know our history, but it's so important that we share that history with other people. And I think that we saw that more than ever last year, where we saw people that weren't of color interested in Black culture, interested in getting educated. And that's so powerful, because it's one thing for you to know where you've come from, but it's another thing to let your brother and sister in, who does not look like you, in on where you've come from too, because then we can actually move forward and progress together. And you'll see that all through Black Broadway and the book itself, of that is how it's always been done throughout history, is that when we unite as a people, we can get more accomplished.
That is so important, because I always reiterate the thought, Black history is American history, and everyone needs to know about it, not just Black millennials, not Black boomers. The whole nation needs to know about history of people from different demographics and backgrounds. And one thing that I love that is, like, your book came out, you know, in January. Mm-hmm. You know, we have to, you know, honor the fact that we've been through a lot this past year. We've been in a pandemic. We've dealt with Black Lives Matter protests. Just a lot has been placed on us. And I want to talk about the timeliness of your book. Can you talk about the importance of it being released in the midst of, like, a racial reawakening?
Yeah, I think that even using the word reawakening is something to think about, because to think that we were ever asleep is a little scary. I think that the timeliness of my book is just literally just timeliness. It was obviously not planned. Didn't expect to be a pandemic. I didn't expect to be having virtual book talks. I thought I'd be in person, you know, with people. But I think it's so important that this book, it came out when it did, because it's a time where not only do we need to get educated, but people that don't look like us are looking at us and are wanting to be educated. And so we have to take advantage of the time and the space that we have right now, where there's an open door for Black culture, right? There's an open door right now to where people are giving us their ear so that we can show them, like, no, this is what matters. This is important. Everyone should be free. Everyone should be treated equally. And even in my book, I do mention a little bit about police brutality. Of course, there's several chapters on, you know, segregation and prejudice, and even to what we see in current times of gentrification. My book goes from the beginning, the very founding of DC as the nation's capital in 1791, up until the ending of 2019. And so it literally goes from slavery to emancipation to what you see nowadays with gentrification. And so I think when you say a racial reawakening, it's so important that we stay awake. My last chapter of my book, I use a narrative from Darren Jones, who works at the Library of Congress. He's great. If he ever sees this, Darren, you're awesome. But he walked me through his time on U Street when he was a council member, a commissioner for the ANC. And he can remember when he was younger and he experienced the 1968 riots when Dr. King was assassinated. And I think that it's important that you brought up millennials, because for us, it is not just a reawakening, it's an awakening, because we did not experience this. We didn't live through segregation. We didn't live through Jim Crow laws. We didn't live through these type of this blatant racism, right? We didn't live through that. But for the generations before us, it's a reawakening, unfortunately, because it's a repeat of what they've already experienced. It's a repeat of the horrors that they've already seen. In his narrative in my book, he talks about how he can remember the riots. He can remember literally the pepper spray in the air. He can remember his mom having to give him a wet rag to put over his face just to walk outside to go down the street. And some of you that are watching this, maybe you grew up on U Street or lived through this time during those riots, and you can remember probably just as if it happened yesterday. And so I think it's important when the timeliness of my book is just to use it as a tool, not just to bring out the bad, but also a tool to bring out the good. I think that's what makes Black Broadway so special, is because it highlights a positive time in history where Black people were free to have their own and to do their own. And if you could do it one time, why not do it again? And we've done it again, right? Our Vice President, Kamala Harris, since it's Women's History Month, she's a graduate of Howard University, and she is what, the first woman in the White House and the first Black woman in the White House as that, as our Vice President. And so that tells you that knowing your history, being educated, focusing on the positive, you can make literally history and make impact and change just like everyone else in my Black Broadway book.
Yes, and speaking of positive, do you have like a fun fact that you could share about the history of U Street or some wonderful, great moments that people shared throughout the time while you interviewed them?
Oh, yes. Okay, I have a lot of fun facts, but I'll just share one or two. But one of the ones is when I first interviewed the Lee family some years ago, and then I interviewed the Ali family as well, but they all know each other, like they've been on vacation together. It's kind of the cutest thing. It's really nice to see how tight-knit the community is. But Virginia Ali, a fun fact is that she used to work, her first job when she moved to DC was as a bank teller at Industrial Savings Bank, which I think is just so interesting to me. Remember I mentioned how a lot of women migrated from the South to the North, but her first job in DC was at Industrial Savings, and that's before she met Ben, that's before she opened up Ben's Chili Bowl with him, and now Ben's Chili Bowl is still standing there in 2021, and just a few doors now she used to work at Industrial Savings Bank. So that's just a fun fact that I think is interesting. And then the other one I'll share very quickly is Duke Ellington. He grew up on T Street, and we know Duke Ellington is a well-known jazz artist. He broke many records. He composed thousands of works. But also in his spare time, when he wasn't practicing playing music over the summer, he used to sell ice cream at Griffith Stadium. And I just think that's like the coolest thing, because we see Duke Ellington as a celebrity, but his time on U Street, he was just a little kid trying to make some summer money selling ice cream. Like, so those are just some fun, you know, positive, uplifting type of facts. But yeah.
I love to hear like little, you know, fun facts like that, because it's like, wow, it's so relatable, you know. And U Street, you know, it's been around since, you said, before emancipation, you know, it's been through Black Broadway era, civil rights era, and even now, you know, as we're dealing with gentrification. But over these times, if U Street could talk, what do you think it would say today?
Yeah, I think if U Street could talk, it would say exactly what you walked through just now. I think U Street would just say, U Street has a lot to say, first of all, right? But I think U Street would say, tell my full story. I ended the chapter of my book with a quote from Dr. Frank Smith, who's the director at the Civil War Museum, which is another remnant that you can go see and get educated and learn more about Black history. But he said this to a researcher that was studying U Street. He said, if we own the story, we own the place. And I think that's what U Street would say. It would say, don't just talk about gentrification, because that's the topic of today, but talk about Black Broadway before things were gentrified. Talk about when U Street was Chocolate City, but then also talk about U Street and the migration and the slaves, and talk about the emancipation and the excitement about that. Talk about Black men getting the right to vote, but then talk about them losing that right to vote. Talk about the crack epidemic, but talk about Marion Barry at the same time and building the Reeves Center. You know, tell the full story of U Street from the highest to the lows. I think U Street just wants the entire story. Don't leave a piece out, right? If we own the story, then we own the place, no matter who moves in or out. If the story is being told correctly, the property still belongs to the heroes of Black Broadway.
Most definitely. And viewers, if you have questions for Brianna, please feel free to share them now. I have one more question I want to ask, and then we're going to put it all over to you all to make sure that you all ask her questions that you all have in mind. But Brie, I want to know, because you know, like you said, we're dealing with gentrification, but I love the fact that, you know, Native Washingtonians and just people that just moved into this area, they're doing whatever is necessary to preserve the history of U Street, you know, through Mochella. When I first moved up here, I learned about go-go, and I said, okay, you know, I'm from the South, I'm from North Carolina, so when I moved up here, I'm like, wow, I never heard of go-go before, but I like it, I really love it. Talk about the importance of, you know, preserving, I already mentioned this, but the amazing feats that people have done to, like, continue to do Mochella and making sure that people know that this is our city, that we're going to preserve the history. We're not going to erase it at all.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, I think if just backing off of Mochella in 2019 with the Don't Mute DC protest, mm-hmm. where we had the issue at the Metro PCS, and Go-Go Music's been playing there for many years, and a neighbor decided that they didn't want the music there because it's too loud. And a group of people decided, oh no, we're going to keep our Go-Go Music. And out of those protests and that summer long thing, and that showed you the how powerful a voice on U Street can be. U Street is only a couple of blocks, right? Only a couple of streets. However, that became national news. Like, that wasn't something that was just relative to the area, but that became national news, and it went on for quite some months, and it ended up with legislation that made Go-Go Music the official music of Washington, D.C. Now, that's something that should have been happened, but it took that kind of activism. It took that kind of preservation of history for us to have change, because legislation, we can see, that's actual change that's tangible, right? And so I think that those are just different things that we can continue to do, is just be active, keep your voice, whatever you are passionate about, don't stop speaking out about it. I mean, social media makes it easy to talk about anything at this point. But yeah, just let's keep spreading love, be positive, and make change, right?
Yes, most definitely. Well, amazing, Bri. I just want to say thanks so much for this lovely talk and providing some insight about your book. Is there anything else that you want to add that I didn't touch on or you want our viewers to know about?
No, I think you touched on just about everything. If anyone has questions, I'd be happy to answer. I'm very excited to hear your thoughts.
Okay. So we actually have a question now. Okay. I'd love to ask you in the chat. It's from Sadiqa Johnson. She said, I'm so impressed with you. Thanks so much for writing this book. What's next for you?
I get that question a lot. So I didn't realize I even wanted to write a book until I wrote this book. So I've been in journalism for some years now. I actually, Brianna knows this, because we went to grad school together. I covered crime in DC for almost 3 years. So that's a big jump from covering crime to writing a history book. But now that I've written the book, I'm like, I can't stop writing. So yeah, so my next book, I'm not sure what it will be yet. I just know that it's going to be inspirational. I definitely want to do something positive still. I just like positivity. I like highlighting things that people maybe haven't known much about or have overlooked, right? And so I think the next book will definitely be inspirational. I can't give you a topic yet, but I'll keep you posted. Okay.
Sounds good. And speaking of, you know, you say, you know, we're both journalists, but you transitioned over to becoming an author. How was that transition for you and like being able to use your journalism techniques and making a book and creating it?
Yeah, so I think the biggest transition from journalist to author would be, I think, just having my actual voice. Because in journalism, unless you're doing long form writing or like a magazine featuring type of writing, for the most part, you're just giving the points, who, what, where, how. And with a book, you have the freedom to kind of tell the story in a way that matters to you or focus on something that matters to you. You get to tell it from a perspective that still gives your personality. Like, I hope when people read Black Broadway, I know my voice is a little squeaky, but when they read it, that they hear me, you know, narrating the story. And I always say that Black Broadway is a narration because U Street has its own story to tell. So I'm not the one, you know, that made the story up. I'm just narrating. And I think that's what made it easy to tell history, because that's kind of what you do as a journalist, right? We are just quoting what other people have said. You don't have necessarily your own opinion, but you're narrating what happened. And I think that's what made it easy for the transition. But what made it harder for the transition from journalist to author was just getting back to not writing so short. Like, with my book, I can be very detailed, I can be descriptive. You know, I have all these images with a news article. It's like, just get to the point. So, yeah.
Yeah. And while I was reading the book, I was, you know, I focused. I mean, I'm trying to like visualize, like, this is this time period. How would it be? You know, when you read books, you try to use your imagination as much as possible. And, you know, someone has a question from Sankofa Video and Books. How long was the research process? Because I was trying to visualize everything and I'm like, wow, Bri just really, you know, she took it back. So how was that process for you?
Yeah, it was about 5 years. That's how long it took for this whole thing to come together. It's about 5 years because I started researching when I was a fellow at Washingtonian. And so it didn't publish until the year after I'd actually already stopped working there, and then it published after. And then from then, a publisher reached out and was like, this is amazing. You should expand this into a book. And I'm like, I'm not an author, so maybe not me. They're like, you should really write a book. So I wrote the book, and here we are. So yeah, it's about four or five years worth of research. Mm-hmm. So definitely a lot of days and nights at the library. Of course, this is pre-pandemic, so I could go places in person, but I'm a little nerd anyway. So I like libraries and museums and dusty files.
Same. What resources did you use to compile all of this information together?
Yeah, so the Library Congress was a huge resource. There's a lot of free material, especially images as well. That was one of the main places, and they have a great online archive, so you can get to things without having to leave the comfort of your home. And then another really, really great resource is also the Historical Society, which I believe is called the Washington Historical Society. I know they just recently renamed it, but that is another, it's within the DC Public Library, but it's upstairs. They've relocated upstairs, and it's like kind of like a privately owned thing, but that is a really good resource as well. They have an entire catalog on U Street history specifically, so.
Okay, sounds great. And we have another question from Sadiqa Johnson. She wants to know, what kind of books did you read growing up? And who are some of your favorite authors?
Yay, so someone actually asked me this question. So let's see, what kind of books? So I always really liked, and I still really like, anything with mystery. And I know when I say this, people are like, why won't you write fiction? I just think fiction takes so much creativity. Maybe one day. Right now I'm gonna stick with nonfiction. But growing up, I used to read a lot of the young, clicky teen type of Twilight books. And then outside of that, I like to read Toni Morrison, and I was really into books like Sula and just those type of, I really like to have something that's serious. On the other hand, I want something that's like not serious, if that makes any sense. I'm always balancing between a pleasure read and something that's educational at the same time. And my next book that I cannot wait to read, I've only started, only got through maybe the first 10 pages, but The Vanishing Half. Sankofa probably sells the book, but I haven't read it yet, so nobody put it in the chat. I don't want any spoilers. But I started it, and I'm like, oh yeah, this is it.
Yeah, so can you talk about like some of your favorite authors? Like, I know sometimes like when we're writing, I can speak for myself, like when I write, I'm like, okay, what would Toni Morrison do? What would Zora do?
Right.
So who are the authors that you feel like you tapped into and had to like investigate?
I think definitely Toni Morrison for sure. I mean, definitely. And I think I wrote so many essays on her when I was in college as well. But it's funny that you mentioned Zora Neale Hurston too, because she actually is a Black Broadway hero. And she spent time on U Street. And also on top of that, another person too, which I'm going to bring in some recent authors who also has written on U Street history. And he is a great, I have it all the way up there, but I'm not going to reach because then who knows what will happen with this. But Blair Rubel, he wrote U Street, a biography, a great author. Another one who was DC native is Maurice Jackson. I know you might've been thinking that I was going to name national, but I want some local names to get out there. But Maurice Jackson, he is a great author. He has a lot of different essays. If you're interested in jazz music, anything of the sort, go get DC Jazz Stories. It's a great book. I don't know if Sankofa carries it or not, but that's another one of my favorite authors too.
Okay. So we have a question from Janet Sims Wood. She wants to know, do you use the Washingtonian division at the Martin Luther King Library?
Mm-hmm. Yep. Okay. Yep, that's a great resource as well. They have a lot of, if you're looking for written material and articles, that is a great resource. Image-wise, that was not my main place for images, but when it comes to looking for articles, digging for old news clippings, any of the court documents, any of the sort, that's a great resource. Really, just about every library in DC is a great resource.
Yeah. And I know that you had like a lot of photos that you had to like shuffle through. How did you decide what photos to use? Because that's helping me, you know, get through the book and just understanding everything as well.
Yeah, so deciding what photos to use, some photos I got from some people I interviewed, which was awesome. And some I had to dig for myself, but I just tried to keep a mix of enough photos that would tell the story, from whether it was a portrait or whether it was a street shot or a wide shot or some images. Like one of my favorite images are of the Capitol Classics Parade, where you see the ladies dressed up, you have the actual, you know, like I wanted to capture the livelihood of Black Broadway because I wasn't there to take pictures. And so famous photographer is Scurlock Photography, and I believe his collection is currently at one of the Smithsonian's. You do have to pay for those images, but I mean, if you are looking for anything in DC from the 1900s, look up Scurlock Photography and you'll find whatever it is you need.
And speaking of like the pictures that you say, you said about like the women dressing up, how was the style back then? Let's talk about that. Because you said they were dressed to impress, like you could not miss when you were on Black Broadway. So talk about that.
Yeah, in words of Richard Lee, you didn't come looking raggedy. So I think I will lean on one of the U Street voices, which is Miss Virginia Ali. I remember interviewing her and she would tell me about how she was just shocked to see how nowadays people are dressed so homely or in jeans and things like that, because that's not how it was, you know, during the Black Broadway era. Everybody was dressed up. Women were in dresses. They were in tights. She said that they used to manicure their nails every single day outside on the porch. And, you know, they made sure their hair was done because they had to be get ready for the nighttime if they were going out with a gentleman or something like that. She she was talking about, I remember interviewing her then, and she was saying that jeans for her were for farmers. That's the exact quote. I mean, you have to realize that now that's normal, but for then it wasn't. She's like, jeans were work clothes. That's something that you would work if, you know, wear if you were working. But for the Black Broadway era, you were dressed up nice because you never know who you were going to meet. I mean, imagine running into Zora Neale Hurston or running into Sarah Vaughan or Pearl Bailey, you know, all of these great voices. You didn't just walk through U Street looking any kind of way. So I think our ancestors, I think they'd be a little disappointed in our quarantine outfits.
Because I'm thinking, like, you know, when outside does open back up, I'm trying to remember, like, what do I need to put on when we go back out, you know?
Think of Black Broadway.
Okay, that's what I'm going to think of. And next time I go back on U Street, I'm like, how should I dress? Let's make sure that, you know, I'm honoring my ancestors in the best possible way. Janet also has another question. She wants to know, how do can she get in touch with you for future book talks?
Yeah, so if you go to my Instagram page at the Black Broadway, I always post whenever I'm doing a book talk. And then if you want to contact me personally, just email me at theblackbroadway@gmail.com. And so if you want me to come somewhere for a talk, whether it's a business or a store or something like that, I'd be happy. Or if it's like a small group, you know, just email me at theblackbroadway@gmail.com. And for future talks, you can also find me on Facebook or follow me at the Black Broadway on Instagram.
Okay, well, thank you so much, Bree. I'm so happy that we were able to talk and learn more about your book. And if anyone has any questions, please feel free to send them over at this moment, because we're almost to the point of wrapping up. And if not, thank you all so much for participating. I'll hand it back over to you, Michaela, to close it out.
Okay, again, thank you so much, Brianna Rhodes, for being our moderator tonight. And thank you to our author, Brianna Thomas. Again, if you would like to purchase the book, Black Broadway in Washington, D.C., you can do so by going to Sankofa.com or coming to our store, 2714 Georgia Avenue, Northwest Washington, D.C. Again, we are a part of that legacy that she speaks about, so it's so special that we can have her here tonight. You guys just got an amazing, amazing treat. I don't think you understand. We just got so much history. We got some beauty lessons in there. You know, we got some culture lessons, and we even got instructions on how to pass it forward, how to talk about our community so that these things don't get lost. So again, thank you so much for being here, not only to our guests, our speakers, but also to our audience. And can we please give them a virtual round of applause? Yes, I see you, audience. Yes, thank you so much for being here. So everyone have a good night. Please stay safe and continue to visit us at Sankofa.com and our YouTube channel, because we archive our events. So if you miss this or you want to show it to someone else, you can show them on our YouTube channel. So everyone have a good night. Thank you so much.
Hi, thanks for coming. Thanks, Nkofa.
No problem. Thank you.